We are upgrading the Sonicare travel case into the future with a shiny USB-C port, saying goodbye to that old school mini USB. But first let's address the toothbrush. Seems it's a common issue in Sonicare reviews. As you can hear, the toothbrush is not working properly and is making some strange noises. To open the toothbrush, we need to remove the bottom part. We must apply pressure to the sides to pry it open, where the vise is useful. But first let's try to remove it with the help of the glue stick. Let's start the timer to understand better how long it will take us to fix this toothbrush. It's time to melt this poor glue stick. And put it on the bottom. Now it will take a few minutes to cool down. Let's see if we can pull it apart. I hope we would make some progress with this approach, but we don't. Going back to the vise idea, you could also use water pump pliers, just make sure to protect the handle of the toothbrush. The goal is to get something between the bottom part and the handle. When we have loosened it enough, we unscrew it from the vise and pry it open. Nice. To lift the guts out of the case, we need to take the flathead screwdriver and loosen the clip from the inside. It is a bit tricky, but it's absolutely doable. Here we go. Here you can see the mentioned clips. The mechanism appears to be crooked, but it's normal for the top to be slightly bent. Let's turn it on in this state. We can clearly hear that these noises are not right. Sometimes the upper screw is loose, what is causing issues. Not in this case. We should look at the top part to see if anything is cracked or has fallen apart. After removing the screw, we can remove the upper part. Nothing that appears to be damaged. Let's screw the part back in place. As far as I know, one more thing could give us trouble. Do you see the red part, the coil? This coil must be a certain distance from the motor to function properly. To adjust the distance, two screws held the coil in place. One of the screws you see here. Let's remove it. The other screw is hidden under the electronics, the PCB. It took me some time to figure out how to get under it. Let me show you. First, let's unsolder the wires of the coil. That makes our life easier. Here you can see that the black plastic part is slidable. To unhook it, we need to get underneath it with a flathead screwdriver or, as you can see here, with a flat side of a spotter. This is how it looks after our removal. Now we have access to the coil and the other screw. Let's unscrew it. Our job is to find a reasonable distance between the coil and the motor. That means we need some kind of spacer. I have some nickel strips lying around that might work. Using a pair of pliers, we will flatten it as much as possible. Pull the coil away from the motor, insert our folded nickel strip and tighten the screws. We remove the nickel strip with the help of a plier. After getting it back together, it still does not sound right. That's annoying. I will spare you the next part as I spend a whole hour trying to track down the problem. After this lost hour, I'm pretty sure that we still have a problem with the distance of the coil. I will disassemble it one last time. Instead of using several layers of the flimsy nickel strip, we will now cut a strip out of this card. It has the same thickness as a regular credit card. Place it in between and tighten both screws as much as possible. By the way, the thickness of the card is 0.77 mm. Both screws are now very tight. Let's put it back together. To prevent the top from coming loose in the future, we will disassemble it. We can see very light rust and dirt. Let's clean it quickly with IPA and a cotton swab. put it back in its place. Let's grab some thread locker to prevent the screw from coming loose in the future. And screw it back on. The next step is to get the rubber inlays in place. We will now carefully slide it back into the case. Nice! It's much quieter now and it works without stopping. Let's lubricate the rubber seal of the button part with generic grease. Now we are going to insert it and push it down to seal it. This must be done with a good amount of force. Great, the toothbrush is fixed. This was quite a long repair. Okay guys, it is time to get the mini USB out of the travel case. We have reset the timer and need to find a way to get to the electronics. To get inside, we will use a pick to release the inner tabs that hold the two halves together. In order to do this, we go along all the sides until we have reached each one of them and set them free. Afterward, we can separate the case. Here we see the PCB of the charging circuit. To remove it, we unscrew the only screw we see. Now we lift it out of the case. To replace the old connector, we use this handy USB-C breakout board. But first we use our trusty microscope camera to remove a terrible mini USB connector. Here we see the VIN minus and VIN plus pins. These are the important ones for our mod. Let's turn it over and fire up our hot air soldering station. We use 500 degrees C to quickly remove the connector, but you can also use a regular soldering iron. Nice. To remove the old solder from the pins, we use fresh flux. The solder wick will absorb all the old solder. It is like a sponge for solder. Let's get rid of the residue with the help of IPA and a cotton swab. We will check if the USB-C breakout board fits in the case. That looks good. We will use flexible and easy to use silicon wires to wire the new board. It's easy to remove the protective layer from the wires. Your fingernail is all you need. We will place the PCB in a holder to solder the wires. To figure out where to put the wires, we will look at the front of the PCB. The front has labels that say VIN minus and VIN plus. Please remember always to use flux for a good solder flow. Let's put solder on the joints. We attach the red wire by soldering it in place. And also the black wire. Afterward, we are cleaning the mess with IPA and a cotton swab. Next step, wiring the breakout board. Fresh solder on the plus and minus joints and soldering both wires in place. Let's try it by putting the PCB back into the case. Insert the toothbrush, connect it with USB-C and nothing? That's odd. Let's take the PCB out of the case and investigate further. We will hook it up to a USB meter, which displays a current flow showing how much power it's drawing. Let's connect it to the board and have a look. Nothing. Please ignore my lights flare, it's just showing zeros. We should check the wiring. Okay, can you spot the mistake? I will give you 5 seconds. I mistakenly wired to the data lines marked plus and minus rather than the V and G pads commonly called plus and ground. Let me quickly fix my rookie mistake. Done. Let's check it out. Finally, we see a current draw. As we approach with the toothbrush, the current draw should increase since it's charging. Nice, the green number shows us around 0.125 ampere. When we take the toothbrush away, the current draw drops down as expected. By the way, if you like stuff like this, you probably know what to do. This setup should work perfectly unless you use a USB-C to USB-C cable. Let me show it to you with this USB meter, connecting it with USB-C and using a USB-C only cable. As you can see, the meter doesn't light up because it doesn't recognize our travel case's charging PCB. It's pretty dirty, we'll give it a quick clean. Let me demonstrate that the setup does work in general. I have a Nintendo Switch here that I rescued in a previous video. When we plug it in, you will see that it starts charging. The USB meter lights up and the console displays a charging bolt. Our travel case charger isn't working because we need a resistor on our board to signal the USB meter that we are a legacy device needing power. We will use a 56k ohm SMD resistor for this. These resistors are tiny, just compare them to my screwdriver's bit. We need to place a resistor between these two pads. As usual, let's apply flux for smoother flow. Get my fume extractor, we shouldn't inhale the harmful fumes during soldering. Let's get some solder on the two pads. Time to pick up our tiny resistor with tweezers. Now for the trickier bit, soldering it in place. This SMD size isn't ideal, but it's all I have on hand right now. One pad soldered, now for the upper one. It's not the neatest job, but it should do the trick. Got the meter in continuity mode, let's see if we goofed and shorted something under that resistor while soldering. We're good, no shorts, now let's switch to ohms mode and give that resistor a check. That looks good, nice. The moment of truth, let's see if our USB-C to USB-C connection works without a hitch now. Boom, it works. Alright, let's get the toothbrush and check if it draws current and charges up. Come on, be a good toothbrush and charge up. Yes, as you can see, it's working. Awesome. Now we can juice it up with nearly any USB-C cable. Fantastic. Now comes the tricky part, making it fit seamlessly and neatly into the case. The new USB-C breakout board needs more room, so we have to snap some of the plastic. We will add some hot glue to our connector to shield our soldering and prevent any wire damage. Let's take the easy route. Just line up the board with the case. To ensure it stays put, we will dab on a good bit of hot glue. The fit looks solid from the outside, but a bit more glue should seal the deal. The glue should be set by now. Let's try joining the two halves together. For added protection on this side, we will lay down a strip of insulation tape. I don't want to be a buzzkill, but it seems like all the hot glue is taking up crucial space, preventing us from properly closing the case. That means just one thing. We need to trim more off the case, carefully prying the connector out of our hot glue jungle, using hot air to soften it up and then applying isopropyl alcohol to ease its removal. We have to set the connector below the PCB, letting it extend just the right amount for a perfect fit. We will grip the connector with ceramic tip tweezers, which won't conduct heat and melt the glue we have already applied to shield the wires. Using this glue, we will initially position the connector in place. Now we will add more hot glue to ensure it's as sturdy as a tank. Let's screw it back into position and reapply the tape. We will use a power bank along with the USB fan to speed up the hot glue drying process. Here's the big test, aiming to join this travel charger together for the last time ever. Let's now test to see if everything still works. After that, we'll make a final adjustment to enhance the finish of the USB-C port. Awesome, it's working flawlessly. Due to the old mini USB connector, we have a slight gap in the case that doesn't look too neat. We will use a white version of Blue Tech from a dollar store to fill this gap. I'm not sure how you feel, but in my opinion, it turned out quite nicely. What's your take? 1 hour and 23 minutes, not bad at all.